Right. So when we talk about the kingdom fungi, you have to keep in mind that we are talking about here prokaryotic or eukaryotic cell. What kind of cells are we talking about?
Eukaryotic.
Right. It is eukaryotic cell. Eukaryotic cells, and are they unicellular or multicellular? Unicellular. Very good. They are mostly, right, most of them are multicellular. Why is it multicellular? Mostly and not all of them, because there is an example, there is an exception where the organism, where a fungi is actually not multicellular and it is unicellular. Can anybody give me an example of that? Anyone can give me an example of a unicellular fungi? Can anyone give me an example? Do you know or not? If not, I will.
Yes, sir.
Yeast.
Very good. Very good. So we have the yeast, or also known as Saccharomyces cerevisiae. Right? That is scientific name. So the yeast is something that is going to be unicellular, while the remaining are going to be multicellular. Now, again, you have to keep one more thing in mind, that these unicellular structures, they are typically filamentous. Okay, they are filamentous, except the yeast. Yeast is unicellular, so they cannot be filamentous. So there is the structure. When we talk about the body organization, we have to understand that they are going to be eukaryotic in nature, they are going to be multicellular in nature, and the body organization is going to be filamentous. Exception is with the fungi, that will be the yeast. The unicellular fungi will be the yeast. Now, there is a unistructure that we see in case of fungi when we talk about the filamentous structure, and that we refer to as the hyphae. Right? So these hyphae are, you know, the strands or this filamentous structure that is going to make the entire body of the fungi. Now, this filamentous structure, they can be of two different types, right? Now, they can be septate or they can be aseptate. So, what I am talking about is, if I am going to have this structure, right? This is my hyphae, single stranded structure or the thin stranded structure. Here, there can be septa. Septa means what? Remember, septum or septa means wall. Okay, in biology, when we talk about septa or septum, right, in class 10 also, when we have learned about the heart structure, probably you would have learned about the word septum or the septa. So here, they are going to form the structure, the septum, and each of these septa is going to divide the entire hyphae into compartments. And that's why these are the cellular structure, and each of these compartments will have only one nucleus. So here, this is called the septate hyphae. It is called septate hyphae. Now, there is another time when we have this entire structure, we have this entire, the hyphae, but here what we see, we hardly see any sort of septum. Okay. And here there is a continuous flow of the karyotes or the nuclei. And here this is called the aseptate. Aseptate hyphae, and here the condition is coanocytic. Coanocytic means what? Anybody? Any idea what coanocytics are? Anyone knows what coanocytic means? You can just tell the difference and you can tell me. Anyone?
So can I?
Yes, Pratima. Or Anjali, I don't know. Somebody was asking, yes. Anyone.
Some hyphae are continuous tubes filled with multinucleated cytoplasm.
Good. That's the answer. Multinucleated cytoplasm. So, very simple difference. In a septate hyphae, as we are going to have the septum or the wall, there is going to be uninucleate condition. But in case of an aseptate hyphae, there is going to be a coanocytic condition where there is going to be a multinucleate cytoplasm, where in the cytoplasm you have a large number of nucleic acids floating around without any septum. And sometimes what happens, the septum might be there, right? Sometimes septum might be there. For example, you might have a condition where the septum might not be complete. It might be partial. So this also, here also, the cytoplasm is going to be continuous or there in continuous contact. And here also they are going to have a quantocytic condition. Now, another term you have to understand is, that is called mycelium. Okay. Now, what happens is, a large number of these hyphae or a networked hyphae is referred to as mycelium. Now, the hyphae is, as I said, they are thin stranded structure, but when they are going to form a network structure, a large number of them together, they are going to form the mycelium. And this mycelium is actually what makes up the entire fungi plant body or fungi body structure. Right? They're going to be consisting of mycelium. And mycelium consists of hyphae. And hyphae can be of two types, septate or aseptate. Now, that is regarding the general overview. Now, the question is, where do they live? Right? So, we use the term habitat to describe the living place or the dwelling place of an organism. Now, can anybody tell me where do you see fungus? All of you have seen fungus. For example, mushroom is a very good example of the fungus. And I hope all of you have seen mushroom. And some of you even might have seen mushroom being grown in certain, inside houses or inside specialized places. Mushroom is grown. We get it in the market, right? So based on that, can you tell me under what condition you think are the mushrooms growing?
Sir, moisture, sir.
Yes, moisture is required, and one more condition is required, very important. Anybody?
Sir, temperature, sir.
Is the temperature much high, high, low, or is like just okay type? Normal body,
Moderate, sir. Moderate.
Little bit higher. We should call it warm, actually, right? Moderate means what I think you are trying to say is actually the warm condition. So here, when we talk about habitat, as you said, moisture, I'm going to use the word warm and humid. Okay, warm and humid condition. So wherever we find a warm and humid condition, water is available, moisture is available, that place, the fungi, if the spores are available, fungi typically produced by spores, right? They can reproduce here. If I talk about the mode of reproduction, the fungi can reproduce by both sexual mode, by producing sexual spores. For example, you have the basidiospore, spore, ascospores, and we have also the asexual mode that is going to be producing the asexual spores. For example, the conidia. Right. So by production of the spores, they will reproduce. So as and when the spores are available, moisture is available, little bit warm condition is available, food material is available, or the nutrition is available, they will quickly start growing. And it is a very common sight when at your home you have fruit, let's say bread or certain fruits, right? And let's say any other vegetable, tomato for example, and you keep it undisturbed, keep it for a very long period of time undisturbed. Over time, what happens is you are going to get fungi, small, fine fibrillar structure is going to come. Cotton structure is going to come out. And within few days, this entire white structure that is going to turn into dark green or black color. That is the condition when you understand the spores have formed. So bread, if you keep a bread and you provide moisture, again the same thing, you see the bread mold growing on it. That's a very common experiment, even you would have done in class. Junior classes, including the class 10th. Yes, somebody was asking something. Okay, hold on the question.
Sir, humus can be affected, sir.
What?
Sir, humus can be affected for...
Humus can be affected for what?
Growth of mushrooms, sir.
Humus can be affected? I don't understand your question, actually. Humus can be affected means humus is a different component altogether. We find it in the soil.
No, sir. Factor, sir. is needed for growth of mushroom.
Yeah, growth of mushroom, again, as I said, the humors are the other components, right? The mushroom can grow even in the wood, right? In the logs, even in the soil, right? Humus is, of course, going to be an important factor. So the substrate, these are called the substrate. For example, we grow the mushroom even in paddy straw, right? So these are called the substrates. So depending on the substrate, it can be, let's say, the cow dung, it can be the humus of the soil, it can be the sand also. Then you have the wood logs, right? It can be different, again, depending on the type of the fungi. But a common thing that is essential for them is a warm and humid condition. That is what we are trying to understand. As we go along, we will try some of the specific examples of that. Okay. Shrikesh or somebody was asking, I guess. Anyways, so I'm going back to the concepts here. So as I said, they require habitat, warm and humid condition, and they will reproduce by different form of spores, both by sexual and asexual modes. And again, we have a differentiation of these, or we have a grouping of this kingdom fungi into different groups, even based on the type of reproduction, the mode of reproduction, into something called imperfect fungi or the deuteromyces that we will learn at a later point of time. So now what I'm going to do is I'm going to now share with you the screen, and I'm going to show you certain pictures and some of the concepts related to what I just spoke now. I think we're done with this. Yeah. I hope you can see the screen.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay, good.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Good. So, on the first page, what you see here is something very extreme, right? Something that you don't see the fungus in our regular world. What we see in our in and around us is typically the bread molds or some other, penicillium, for example, or the mushroom. But what you see here, two examples of something very different. But these also belong to the kingdom Mycota. The wrinkled peach fungus on the top left and the top right is going to be the Clatrus rubber. Both of these look very different. They does not look something like a fungi, but they look beautiful. But again, they belong to the kingdom Mycota. Now here also what you see, again two different forms of the mushroom. On the right side, what you see is the edible mushroom. Then again, you have these two images where you see are the plant pathogens. Right, the fungus we know, are they autotrophs or heterotrophs? Fungus are autotrophs or heterotrophs? What do you think?
Heterotrophs. Heterotrophs, sir.
Very good. So fungus, we know they are heterotrophs. They do not have any sort of chlorophyll pigments with them. So they depend on others. So here, they work as parasites, right? They are going to act as the plant pathogens. They cause some of the disease like the rust or smuts in the plants. They damage the plants, but again, they survive by this mode. Now here, again, some of the commonly observable, scenario that we see around bread mold, for example. Then you have the fungus growing in the fruits or the tomatoes. Now, as I was saying earlier, on this part, what you see is, on this part, what you see is, this is the white part, right? So here, white part is the first formed fungus. Now, as the time progressed, you see this become darker and darker, right? So why this happens is, this particular part where you're going to have the darker color, this is the place where the fungus is actually going to an advanced stage, has grown already, and they're going to form the spores. But here, the spores typically may not be formed. They're actually in the early stage of development. Now, we already talked about this. So they are going to be having the hyphae and mycelium. And you can see an example of that. You can see how the hyphae are present. And this hyphae, they're going to form specialized structure, and that is called sporangium, where the spores are actually formed. And you can see again, another food material on which the fungus is growing. And when we zoom in, see, this is like a cottony mass. And when we zoom in, we see the entire fungus, this white parts, these are nothing but the vegetative structures, and this black structure, black dots, these are the sporangium or the spores are going to be produced. Again, we already talked about this. The hyphae can be septate or aseptate or non-septate or guanocytic, we call it, right? So you can see here there is going to be complete septa or the wall, but here there is no wall, and there is one called pseudo hyphae, right? That is in case of yeast cell. Now again, this is the same thing. Mycelium. Here, this we are talking about the hyphae, and as I said, hyphae, actually branched hyphae structure, together they are referred to as the mycelium. And you can see the mycelium can be branched, as you see here. Right here, this particular part, let's say, can be a hyphae, and here it is going to be a septate hyphae. Each of the part is going to have one nuclei each, and on this side again, you can have another image of the septate and aseptate or guanocytic hyphae. Now, here is the structure of the yeast. Again, something unique. We have this unicellular fungi, the only one, and you know, yeast reproduce by they form the bud or the budding, and you have a very simple structure here. On the outer side, you have the cell wall followed by the periplasm, or that is a space between the cell wall and the plasma membrane. And inside, again, you have some of the eukaryotic structure, like the membrane bound structure, like the nucleus, you have the peroxisomes, you have Golgi apparatus, ER, vacuoles, right? Mitochondria. These are all the eukaryotic structure that you do not see in case of the prokaryotes. So that is the structure of the yeast. Again, another structure of another fungus, that is going to be your regular fungi mushroom, we call it Agaricus. We will talk about this a little bit later, but as you can see, this is called the fruiting body. This is the cap and spores. These are called the gills, and the spores here are actually produced on this side. So again, we are going to talk about that, but again, you see here the mycelium. Mycelium here is going to be forming the entire structure. Now, mode of nutrition, it can be saprophytic, right? It can be parasitic, or it can be a symbiont, right? Yesterday we are talking about it. What do you mean by symbiont? Symbiont is a mutualistic interaction between, right, lichens, for example, is a mutualistic interaction between the fungi and the algae, where both the fungi and algae benefit from each other, right? So how does the algae actually benefit? The algae benefit as it is going to get a shelter. It is going to be provided with the requirements for the raw materials for the photosynthesis, and the fungi benefits by getting the food materials from the algae. So both of these are organisms are going to benefit from each other, and that is the lichen. Now, the second symbiotic example that we see, symbiotic mode of nutrition we see in case of fungus, is going to be mycorrhiza. Now, mycorrhiza is an association of the fungi with the roots of higher plants. Here also fungi gets a shelter, and the fungi in turn help the plant to obtain phosphorus and some other nutrients from the soil in an easy manner. Just remember what are symbiotic mode of nutrition in this particular case in fungi, that is lichens and mycorrhiza. And now on the left side, what you see here is an image of the lichen. Now we do have the sample specimen in the laboratory also. Once you're back, you can see. And you can see here, this is the outer layer and this is the lower area. And inside what you have, this particular area, you can see the algal components. And also here, we have the fungal components. So both of them are so intertwined, we may not be able to differentiate. And each of them are going to live as a single unit, and they benefit from each other's presence. Are you able to follow what I'm speaking, my dear students?
Yes, sir.
Okay, good. So we also spoke about. So we also spoke about the reproduction modes. That is, we have the sexual mode and asexual mode. And as I was talking about, there are going to be a formation of spores. Asexual spores, you have conidia, then you have sporangium spores, juice spores. And in sexual modes, we have oospore, ascospore, basidiospores. Anyway, we'll talk about that in the different classes. Now, there are three steps when we talk about the sexual mode. Now, here what happens, the first step is going to be fusion of the protoplasm, right? When you have the two hyphae coming together, right? The motile or the non-motile gametes, they're going to fuse together, and the protoplasm only fuses and not the nuclei, right? The nuclei do not fuse. And this particular process is called plasmogamy. So plasmogamy is the first step in the sexual mode of reproduction in case of fungi. Now this is followed by the fusion of the two nuclei, and that is called karyogamy. Karyon refers to nucleus, gamy refers to fusion. So karyogamy, second step. And finally, what happens is you get the zygote. Zygote is going to be diploid in nature, and this zygote undergoes meiosis. Meiosis is what? Reduction of cell division, and that will give it to the haploid spores. So from the plasmogamine, we get the fusion of the male and gametes, motile gametes or non-motile gametes. The protoplasm fuses, followed by karyogamy, where the nuclei fuses, give rise to the zygote that undergoes meiosis to give rise to the haploid spores. Now, what you see here is the asexual spore in case of conidia, right? Conidia, in case of penicillium. On the left side, what you see is the penicillium, and on this part, this is the penicillium, okay, growing on the lab. And this part, these are the chain of conidia. They are born on the structure. Well, this structure is called conidiospore, conidiophore actually. Anyway, you don't have to know about that in detail right now, but again, if you know, it is good. So these are called the conidiophore, and you see this chain of conidia. Each of these structure are called 1-1 conidia, and each of them, when they're released, they can give rise to a new fungi, that is new penicillium. Now, next we have is the dikaryon stage. As I said earlier, right, what happens is we are going to have the fusion of two nuclei called karyogamy. Now, after plasmogamy, in some case what happens, there's an immediate fusion of the two nuclei, but in some case they do not fuse, right? And this particular stage where you have an intervening stage without the fusion of the two nuclei, but the protoplasm is fused, that is called dikaryotic stage. So here you have two haploid nuclei, and they do not fuse. It is not 2n, it is n plus n. And this condition is called dikaryon, and this phase is called dikaryophase of the fungus. But later on, what happens, these nuclei fuse and they give it to the diploid zygote. And from there, when the meiosis occurs, we have the haploid spores formed. So what I'm speaking is, as you can see here, we are having one mycelium here and second mycelium, hypha or mycelium you can call it. And these are separated ones, you can see, and here this is one strain, one type, and this is another, this is plus and minus type, and here they're going to fuse, and you see they do not immediately produce the diploid structure. Instead, they are in an intermediate stage, right? You see this, there is an intermediate stage where each of the cell is going to be consisting of two nuclei, that is going to be n plus n, haploid and haploid, and that is what is called a dikaryon stage or dikaryo phase of the fungi. I hope you are clear on that, but we are going to go back, we are going to see this particular life cycle a little bit later also. So did you understand the sexual life cycle in the fungi? Three step and the dikaryon stage. Did you understand that?
Yes, sir.
All of you are able to understand? Am I going fast?
Yes, sir.
Good. So let us continue and understand the next concept. Okay, I hope you can see again. Okay, let's move on. Then, as I said, there are four classes, and these four classes again are based on certain features. One of the prime features is going to be the ability of reproduction. Some of the groups here, they are going to reproduce both by sexual and asexual. Some of them reproduce by only sexual mode, and some of them reproduce exclusively by asexual mode. So anyway, let's talk about each of the class. The first class is going to be the phycomycetes. And here, these are aquatic organisms, aquatic fungi, and they actually live in decaying wood in moist and damp places. They're obligate parasites. Obligate parasite means they have to depend. They are actually always living as a parasite. There is no other option. They have to live as parasite. And the mycelium here, right, mycelium that we're talking about is going to be aseptate and coanocytic. Remember, the primitive feature of the mycelium is aseptate. But as we go to the next groups, higher groups, we will see septate and not aseptate. So the first group, the primitive group, is going to be having the aseptate mycelium, that you keep in mind. The reproduction here is going to be through asexual mode, that is with the help of the motile spore called the zoospore and the non-motile spore called the aplanospores. Now, you see one of the examples here. You see, in case of asexual condition, what happens is you have the, this is called the hyphae, right? and you have the specialized hyphae called the sporangiophore. Now the sporangiophore is going to have a columella, and the columella is going to connect it with the sporangium, and this sporangium is going to form the spore, asexual spores. And when the sporangium is released, the spores are going to be released, and each of the spores can give rise to a new organism, new fungi altogether. So this is the way the asexual reproduction occurs in this particular case. Now the asexual spores produce endogenous. Endogenous means what? On the inner side, they are going to produce on the inside of the sporangium. And you can see three examples here. That is, on the first one, top left is going to be the mucor. Then you have the rhizopus. Rhizopus is what? This one is nothing but the bread mold, right? You keep the bread and you put moisture in that. After a few days, you see the cottony mass. That is the rhizopus or the bread mold. And finally, what you have is the albugo candida. Again, this is a plant parasite. Now, the next class of fungi is called the sac fungi. As you can see, a beautiful fungi, beautiful looking fungi actually on the left. This is not 3D again, it is a real image of a fungi, and it is going to belong to the ascomycetes, also known as, commonly known as, the sac fungi. Now here, the fungus body is going to be multicellular, and it is going to be really unicellular. Now the yeast, if you remember, it belongs to this particular class. And here, the mode of nutrition is going to be the saprophytic, decomposers, parasitic, especially for the plants. And you have the coprophilus. What is coprophilus? Fungi that can grow on dung. That is called coprophilus. That is what I said. Sometimes you would have seen that sometimes the, let's say, cow dung can have a very small mushroom like structure with a black, the cap like structure. Right. So that is the coprophilus, or they grow on cow dung. The mycelium here is going to be branched and septate, right? This is the difference. In the previous case, what you saw? It was aseptate, but from now on, we're going to see the septate mycelium. That's an advanced feature that has developed over the evolution time period. In the beginning, it was aseptate, but over time, it has become septate and it is again branched. Now, when we talk about the reproduction method, asexual reproduction occurs through the help of conidia, just like what you saw in the earlier case. You have the conidiophores and you have the conidia that is going to be formed, right? For example, you have the penicillium, you have the aspergillus. Now these are responsible even for the production of many of the important antibiotics. Anyway, so when we talk about sexual reproduction, they form a nice fruiting body like you saw in the first case, right? Now this is going to be the fruiting body, the structure that is developed, that we typically see and we sometimes consume. Now that is called the fruiting body, and here it is called ascocarp. Okay, I think I made a mistake. Yes, it is correct. I'm sorry, it is correct. Ascocarp. Now here you can see these structures here are called the asci, right? And inside the asci, you have the ascospore that is going to be produced. Now this is a cup-like structure, the sac-like structure that is going to be called the fruiting body. And you can see these are all the mycelia. And these are going to be these structures, which you can see here. These are called the the asci, inside which you have the sexual spore, that is ascospore. Now, fine. Now here, as I said already, the reproduction asexual spore is called conidia, produce exogenously on the outside the conidiophores. Now I'm going to quickly go back and tell you the difference here. Now what do you see here? There is no sporangium. It is not produced inside the sporangium. It is produced on the outside. That's why exogenous. Now, if I go back a little bit to the previous group, you see what? You see the sporangium. Inside the sporangium, you have the development of the spore. So it's called endogenous. But in the second case, it is going to be called the exogenous. So here, the asexual spores are produced exogenously on the conidiophores. And the sexual spores, which are called ascospores, are going to produce inside. Right? It is going to be produced inside, as you can see in these pictures. And that's why it is called endogenous in the asci. Asci are the structures inside which you have the spores. And the asci are organized into the fruiting body called the ascocarp. This entire structure is called ascocarp. Right, again, you can go through this. It is an additional information later on. You can see that. I'll share this entire thing. And examples, when we talk, you can see some of the ascomycetes. For example, you have the penicillium, you have the one more example, I think we had said already. Aspergillus, you have, right? and then you have the claviceps. This one is the claviceps purpurea, right? So these are some of the examples of the sac fungi or the ascomycetes fungi. Now there are certain edible sac fungi also. On the left, what you see is the models, right? They are edible. And on the right side, what you see is the truffles. The models and truffles are the edible sac fungi. Again, many of them known to again act as parasite. Now the next class is going to be called the basidiomycetes. Now here, the basidiomycetes, for example, you have the soil, they are going to live on the tree, soil or logs, for example, and they are also going to grow as parasites. Right, in the beginning, I showed you the plant leaves with the infection, that is the rust and spots, and they belong to this particular class, basidiomycetes. And here, as you can again, you see the mycelium is branched and septate, and the reproduction mode is going to be vegetative mode and sexual reproduction, but the asexual mode is completely absent. Now, when vegetative mode, it is going to be fragmentation. Now, when we talk about sexual mode, there are all going to be two different strains or two different somatic cells, they're going to come together and they're going to form the basidium, right? So what happens, you saw earlier, there are two different strains, positive and negative strains. They come together, they are going to undergo plasmogamy. They are going to form then the dikaryophase, and then they're going to form the diploid structure that is going to undergo the mitosis. So they're going to form the basidium. This is the fruiting body. And finally, the basidium, under this basidium, right, it is going to contain the spore. It is going to undergo meiosis and produce four haploid nuclei, four different basidiospores. And these basidiospores, again, they form the diploid structure here, as you can see. So here, they form the basidium, and the basidium is going to produce the spores, the basidiospores, because of the karyogamy and meiosis. And there again, exogenously developed, that is, they produce outside the basidium, right? This is the basidium, and four of the spores are produced outside, and they are not produced on the inside. And the fruiting body here, this particular fruiting body is called basidiocarp. Right, so here you have this entire fruiting body of the basidiocarp, and on the inner side, this is called the gills. Mushroom, you all have seen, right? On the inner side, you can actually separate them out. And if you take a small part of that and you see the infoldings. And in each of these infoldings, you have millions of these spores called the basidiospores. Again, examples, you have the agaricus or the mushroom. Then you have the istilago or the smut. Again, these are parasite plant pathogens. And you have the puccinia. This causes the rust. And again, you can see they are also plant pathogens. And we are coming to the last class here, and that is the imperfect fungi, or also referred to as the deuteromycetes. Now here, the reproduction is by only asexual mode or vegetative mode. And they are called imperfect fungi for the simple fact that there is no sexual mode of reproduction in this case. Now, when the sexual forms of these fungi, which are placed here, they're found, then they're going to be placed into the other three class that we learned about. And the asexual spore, which is produced here, is going to be simply the conidia. And mycelium is going to be septate and branched. And some of the members, some of the fungi here are going to be saprophytic and parasitic. And most of them are going to be decomposers. And they play a very important role in the mineral recycling. Right? The minerals, for example, from the plants and animals, when they died, they have to decompose and they have to be sent back to the soil and other parts. So the mineral recycling is an important factor in the environment or in the biosphere, and they are going to help in that process. Now here we have three examples. Again, you can see Alternaria on the left side, the spores you can see. Then you have Colletricum on the center, again a plant pathogen, and Trichoderma on the right side. So these are some of the examples of the kingdom, right? So with that, we are coming to an end for this particular kingdom fungi. Kingdom fungi is over from my side for the theory part. Now, if you have any doubts, please ask me quickly. Anyone is having any doubts, or are you clear on that?
Excuse me, sir.
Yes, sir, Samiksha, tell me.
Sir, yesterday actually I joined little late due to network issue. So I couldn't get some concepts, sir. I'm having doubt.
Okay, so no problem. After the class, give me a message. I will clarify your doubts directly.
Sir,
I will clarify.
Can I ask one doubt?
Yes, ask.
Sir, in a paramecium, what is the difference between pellicle and cilia?
See, pellicle is the entire protein layer. There is no cell wall. So instead of cell wall, outside the cell membrane, you have the pellicle. Right, there is a protein layer, thick layer. Cilia are the small bristle-like structure that is present throughout again, but they are small bristle-like. They are going to help in the locomotion. They are going to help in the movement. But pellicle is a a protein layer that is present throughout. For example, protection outside the cell membrane instead of the cell wall. So they are very different. Cilia and flagella, they are typically for movement. Pellicle is not for that. Clear on that?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Sir,
excuse
yesterday
me, sir.
You asked to go through a question, sir.
Yes, macro and micronucleus. So macronucleus is the nuclei that is going to help in the regular. They have all the genes that are essential for the vegetative development, right? But the micronucleus is essential for the reproduction. Without the micronucleus, the organism
genetic material is there, sir.
Yeah, in both genetic material is there, but the micronucleus is essential for reproduction. Macronucleus is essential for the regular growth. Okay. We are running out of time. It might close anytime soon. If you still have anything else, tomorrow, again, we have a class. So keep your question on that, on these concepts.